infamous debate, the YSU debate in 2014 between college Democrats and college conservatives, really to educate kids of our age, kids of our generation at Youngstown State, because we want them to be able to go out and make an educated vote and really inspire them to go out and vote, because it's important that we all get our ideas out and we show our power at the polls.
Well, I came because I think it's very important that college Democrats and college students get involved in the political process, because the decisions we're making now are the ones that they're going to have to live with, so they should have skin in the game by participating in the political process.
Well, I came because I think more and more young students, young kids, have to get more involved in politics. It's increasingly more difficult when those of us who are involved in politics and in government find that there aren't too many followers. People aren't that interested. So civics, government, I'm here because I think kids are getting involved, young adults are getting involved, and I think it's important.
Well, I decided to come to the debate today between the college Democrats and college conservatives because I thought it'd be interesting to see what the viewpoints were of the campus students here at YSU. As I've seen both sides, some of their stances, but I'd like to see how the stances are taken, particularly here at YSU.
Hi, I came to the debate today basically just for fun. I love the debating atmosphere, and I want to see how both parties end up playing out against each other.
I'm debating ISIS today at the political debate. Foreign policy is a real big passion of mine, and I think it's a great way to have this debate so students can become involved and understand the issues that they might be voting for in the future, and to understand what's going on in America so they can really develop an interest in politics.
President Obama has failed to adequately respond to the threat ISIS presents domestically and internationally. Not only has the administration delayed its reaction, but it has been advised by the intelligence community for over 2 years about rapidly growing, highly structured groups that we call ISIS. So why are airstrikes and supply drops inadequate reactions? In reality, ISIS is highly organized, well-funded, and they have territory and highly large membership, and better equipped thanks to Obama and his attempts to arm Kurdish forces. That's right, if you haven't heard, instead of putting troops on the ground, he has dropped U.S.-funded weapons that landed in ISIS' hands. I was one of the last combat troops to leave for Kirkuk, Iraq in 2011 with the U.S. Cavalry Division. I, as well as fellow soldiers, knew we were leaving poorly trained Iraqi soldiers to fend for themselves. We believe Obama's withdrawal troops left no residual forces protect the area we left. This was confirmed last year when 30,000 Iraqi troops fled only 1,000 ISIS soldiers in Mosul, neighboring city of Kirkuk. President Obama claims to defeat ISIS with airstrikes paired with weak Iraqi and Kurdish forces allows us to do little more than contain ISIS for the time being. So how should we deal with ISIS in Iraq and Syria? How about President Obama take the advice of General Dempsey and deploy troops to aid the Iraqis pushing back ISIS? It is important we quickly destroy ISIS with aggressive ground attacks headed by Iraqi and Kurdish troops, and then weigh our options in Syria. We need to develop a plan to dismantle their leadership and their finances. Failure to destroy ISIS will greatly compromise our security and the world's security. As we saw an example in Canada last week when a government building was attacked by ISIS.
Thank you. And in contrast to the statements previously made, I would just like to bring up the comments that Barack Obama made following the beheading of Stephen Soltoff. I'm sure you've heard about it. He vowed to degrade and ultimately destroy the terrorist group ISIS. I would also like to point out that during the Bush administration, he also made similar vows. And more than a decade after launching the war on terror, both war and terror are indeed still raging. So what is the Obama administration policy towards ISIS right now? Basically, Obama's foreign policy priority in his first term was to bring troops home from Iraq, and he's done that. And he has promised that he will not be dragged into another ground war. So instead of offering troops in combat areas, he is offering training, intelligence, and equipment to those Iraqi and Kurdish forces that are fighting ISIS in the Middle East. For stressed the importance of counterterrorism efforts to cut off funding, as he addressed in his speech at the beginning of September. I found the fact that in August, ISIS was receiving money from Kuwait and Qatar, and meanwhile, Saudi Arabia was funneling weapons to Syrian rebels and did not care if they ended up in ISIS hands. Since then, Arab countries have begun to participate in airstrikes alongside the United States, and those countries include the United Arab Emirates, Jordan, Bahrain, Qatar, and Saudi Arabia. So, in reference to the counterterrorism efforts to cut off funding, they have been successful thus far and will continue to do so as long as we continue to improve our intelligence. Further, the United States held the presidency of the Security Council in September, and it became a priority to pass a resolution on ISIS when Obama was president in the meeting. And he stated directly that there is no military solution to the problem of misguided individuals seeking to join terrorist organizations, and it therefore called on nations to work together to counter the violent extremism. So a multilateral approach to ISIS is the only way to handle this, through diplomacy and international cooperation.
I was there, I saw it, they were not ready. So we left, and now we have seen everything fall. But there's women's rights that are at risk. Everything's at risk. All the tax dollars we put into schools, equipment, tanks, armors, they have them all. And they're at risk of being lost to ISIS, making ISIS even more of a threat.
Thank you, Mark. Abigail?
To further reiterate yet that, yes, we did draw troops out of Iraq too soon. However, it was because of the policies enacted by the Bush administration that their presence there was not successful. In 2003, the Bush administration launched a war in Iraq that led to the dismantling of state institutions under a process known as de-Baathification, in which members of the dominant Ba'ath Party under Saddam Hussein were barred from political participation. This has led some commentators to suggest that the vacuum left in the wake of the U.S.-led invasion was a major factor in allowing rapid spread of ISIS in Iraq. Further, CNN commented that unable to serve under the new Iraq government after Saddam Hussein's military was disbanded, former Iraqi soldiers became ISIS fighters. So due to the policies of the Bush administration in sending in troops and overthrowing the government in Iraq, it actually caused ISIS to exist.
We have to put troops on the ground. It needs to be done. Airstrikes aren't going to do it. Drones can't do it. And we can't just sit around and wait for 9/11 to happen again or anything crazy in a big city of America. It has to be done.
Again, I would just like to stress that obviously combat troops have not been successful in dealing with terrorist organizations in the Middle East, and that diplomacy is the answer. It has been suggested several times throughout the Security Council and the United Nations that an international coalition is necessary to bring nations together to fight ISIS. United States was really looked favorably upon the Gulf Cooperation Committee, which includes Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, and Oman, to become involved as it is more of a rich area. And we believe that also the involvement of Turkey in combating ISIS would be effective. It's more of an international involvement situation rather than just sending in troops that wouldn't really be effective if the United States did it. However, regional bodies, as though they already are in Syria and the Kurds are also fighting ISIS in the region, it isn't really effective to have more bloodshed from American.
About a hand.
The absence of effective government regulation on fracking has allowed for environmental degradation. According to Deborah Rogers of the U.S. Extraction Industries Transparency Initiative, quote, the shale industry emits significant amounts of nitrogen oxides and volatile organic compounds in their day-to-day operations. Pennsylvania's Department of Environmental Protection alone estimated in 2011 emissions of these toxins at a rate of 19,300 tons per year. Moreover, Dr. Gene Van Breesen of Carnegie Mellon University finds that with regard to chemical islands in place of fracking fluids, 29 were identified as of particular concern for human health, and 13 were identified as carcinogens. This fluid is injected deep into the ground to fracture shale beds and release natural gas trapped therein. It also results in two different forms of waste, flowback and produced water, both of which contain the previously mentioned poison. Unfortunately, as Dr. Membries notes, federal and state safeguards should protect people and the environment from the hazards of fracking have not kept pace with the expanding industry. As a result, this development has proved dangerous, destructive, and polluting. The second issue pertains to the economic aspects of fracking. First, negative health externalities must be a part of the discussion. The American Lung Association quantified the health costs of air pollution from nitrogen oxide and volatile organic compounds, estimating that the impact of such pollutants on the health of the people who live in regions where ozone is prolific comes to about $1,648 per ton of emissions. Remember that in PA alone, there are 19,300 tons of these substances emitted per year. That's an estimated negative externality of $31,806,000. Moreover, current positive economic projections with relation to fracking are dubious. David Kay of Cornell University finds that existing evidence about the Marcellus Shale gas operations is inadequate to make predictions about the numbers of jobs that will be created, business expansion, or revenue generation with high levels of confidence. The rising tide is not likely to lift all boats. There will be losing constituencies among communities and individuals who are displaced or left behind. Moreover, the experience of many economies based on extractive industries is a warning that their short-term gains frequently fail to translate into lasting community-wide economic development. Most alarmingly, in recent decades, credible research evidence has grown, showing that resource-dependent communities can and often do end up worse off than they would have been without exploiting their resource reserves.
My opponent spoke a lot about flowback and the water resources that are utilized during hydraulic fracturing. Now, I just want to speak to that. I'm glad you went into a study about that. But the fact of the matter is, there are countless studies on both sides of the matter. I mean, I can list EPA studies that there was a 16-month investigation of water wells in Franklin Forks, Pennsylvania. No sign that this flowback got into drinking water wells or escaped from the safeguards that were in place. Lisa P. Jackson, EPA administrator under President Obama, has testified twice in Congress that there is no evidence that fracking contaminated groundwater with this so-called flowback. The reality is this flowback is contained in a highly complex series of pipes that are designed to pull the water that is used to fracture the rock underground. It's designed to pull it up and keep it safe. It is encased in at least five layers of cement and steel in between each of those layers. And as far as migration of the gas into water wells, which is another environmental issue that has been brought up by the anti-fracking community, that's simply false as well. The gas that may get trapped underground is again taken up by one of those layers of cement, which are in a hierarchical kind of setup. One stops at one layer of rock, one stops at the next to prevent that from leaking out and going into groundwater, which is significantly higher, a couple thousand feet higher than the shale that is fracked underneath. As far as the economy is concerned, fracking brings jobs to Ohio, brings jobs to northeastern United States, all of the depressed industrial areas. It far outweighs any negatives that are associated with additional greenhouse gases being emitted from trucks and operations that are moving around the area. That can all be cleaned up by using natural gas as a fuel source for these same vehicles. Natural gas emits 50% less pollutants than other fossil fuels, and that is important to focus on. The science is proven, the science has been tested, and it's time that we move to natural gas with this safe method of extracting it from our soil and energy.
All right, so very quickly, touching on the first point about the environment. So my counterpart mentioned the EPA, and very specifically, the EPA examines the methods of disposal of these fluids that are used to fracture the shale beds. And although it is true that class one wells are a safe method of disposing of this fluid, the problem is that current regulations don't mandate that these companies are disposing of the fluid that they're using in class one wells. They're using class two wells, which have been scientifically proven, one, to be hazardous as a means of disposing of this fluid, the second, increasing the likelihood of earthquakes. So when we're talking about the environment, we're not actually seeing a benefit stemming from this practice of hydraulic fracturing. And if you want anecdotal evidence, look to the fact that currently when water is coming out of faucets in areas in the Marcellus region, it's literally on faucet. Now, very second to the economy, he mentioned jobs, but he doesn't actually give you a number. So I think that's very important. We can't actually weigh the economic benefits or detriments if we don't have quantifiable statistics. But second, remember that the health externalities are actually reducing the amount of revenue that we can be generating because the actual practice of fracturing is causing health defects that cost money to treat people. So there's that consideration. And thirdly, we have to look at what the Federal Reserve in Cleveland shows us about the statistics in this area specifically. We are seeing an increase in hospitality housing, but the one thing that indicates is that we're actually bringing people from out of Ohio to come into Ohio to work these jobs. These jobs are not going to Ohio. There isn't an economic benefit.
I'm glad that you brought up the disposal of the wastewater that does not migrate into drinking water wells. That's something I didn't mention, and I'd like to. General Electric is actually in the process of producing a system where the wastewater that is extracted from a fracking operation can be reused in its entirety, and will also bring down the amount of water that needs to be used. This is the kind of economic development that's happening right here at home. Companies like GE, American companies, great American corporations like this, are innovating and making sure this science continues to progress. We shouldn't be afraid of the science. We should be investing in it. We should be making this better. Every industrial process comes with concerns. It is the job of humans to continue to perfect these sciences so that we can move forward in the economy and in the way we live our lives. I'm glad you also mentioned the water faucets too, because it's been proven that where those have been documented, especially by Josh Fox in his documentary, "Everything's Gasland," where he sets the water on fire. In those locations, which is a reason that they're prime locations for hydraulic fracturing, there is already a lot of methane that migrates into water wells. This is something that's not new. And as far as the economic development, you have to look at the anecdotal evidence, because this idea that fracking helps the economy expands into other sectors of the economy. For instance, small towns in central Pennsylvania, sales tax revenue is up 25 to 70%. That's incredible. That means there's more economic activity happening in these towns, giving people more jobs, more hours. This is the kind of economic development that we need to see. We've seen in Pennsylvania, and now here in Youngstown.
Environment. We're having a dispute of evidence, and that's fine. But in all, I'm going to rely on the numbers that the PA and the Environmental Protection Agency and the American Lung Association give you. You're not only having health estimates, but you're having negative cost externalities as a result of recession. But secondly, looking at economy, it's very important to note that, again, we don't have any quantifiable evidence on their side. What we have are anecdotes, but I have David Kidd from our university who's telling you that when you study the numbers, when you study the literature, you aren't seeing long-term economic benefits. You're seeing short-term benefits and then long-term benefits. Thank you.
For as many statistics and numbers that you can pull up about the migration of wastewater and the misuse of wastewater, I can bring up plenty more. Dish, Texas, one of the places where fracking was first started, they installed many air monitoring devices, and they have never found air quality to be reduced by that. Now here at home, I think that we need to put faith in the fact that this is giving people jobs. These wells don't just spring out of nowhere. People have to operate them. People have to draw the maps to locate where these go. People have to survey the locations of the lots. There are thousands of these wells. You can't tell me that they don't create jobs and they don't allow people to get back to work. Berkeley, we've gotten a lot of our energy from the Middle East. That is where ISIS is flourishing. That's where terrorist organizations in the past have flourished. And that's where America is sort of involved in conflicts that, frankly, the conservative belief is that we shouldn't be involved in all of these. And that's a great opportunity for us. We have found that Marcellus Shale has allowed us to become more energy independent. Look at the price of a barrel of oil right now on your phone. It's probably hovering around $80. A couple months ago, that was up over 100. This is because nations like Saudi Arabia and OPEC are flooding the market with oil and gas that we are creating here at home. So the market is flooded with this. This is a great opportunity for us to become energy independent and to get out of these conflicts that are focused on things like oil, unfortunately.
Okay, and ideally, the United States doesn't want to rely on any other country for its energy. But the problem is that the goals generally of the Republican Party are generally short-sighted. We can gain some energy independence with these non-renewable resources that, one, again, are causing health deficits, and two, not resulting in long-term economic stimulus. But what we should actually be investing in is sustainable. So at the end of the day, if we're talking about, you know, whether it's energy that we're getting from the Middle East in terms of oils or energy that we can harvest domestically in regard to natural gas, there's no long-term solvency with either of these sources of energy. We need to be sustaining green energy, sustainable energy, and either way, you're going to end up coming down to your dependency on Middle Eastern oils.
Great. Thank you. How about it? Work number one. How should personal income tax
how should personal income be taxed? And two, do tax cuts for businesses stimulate the economy?
23% consumption tax. Now, consumption tax is pretty much the same thing as a sales tax. And you can exempt the necessities such as food, water, and in this day and age, let's face it, utilities, internet, and BOGO are essentials for just having a job, so they would be exempt as well. Consumption tax is the most tax, or the most neutral tax that we have discovered so far. Income tax promotes less working. It's also kind of depressing to get your paycheck and see that, well, if you work in Cancun like I do, around 20% of your money is gone. Property taxes discourage property. I mean, if you're going to get taxed on it, you might as well just rent it. Savings taxes discourage investments into our economy. What's the point of buying all these stocks or investing in a business if you're getting taxed on it and you're losing profit? A consumption tax will discourage buying things in excess. And in America, we do a lot of that. There is a lot of waste, and consumption tax could help prevent that a little bit. And honestly, no matter what people are going to buy, luxury items, it's going to happen. Now, the tax cuts create stimulation in the economy. Sort of. Big businesses don't really need the extra help. They have enough money. If they're going to stimulate the economy, if they're going to spend more on the economy, they're going to spend it. They have the resources to do so. Now, with a small business, it could be detrimental to them because if they're looking to expand and they don't think they have the money, but a tax cut will help them expand, they'll use that extra money. But if they don't renew, if they don't get the tax cut the next year, they could end up either folding or losing their expansion. So any stimulation in the economy created by that would be gone. Am I saying that we should completely eliminate tax cuts for businesses? No, I think they're very useful in trying to promote or discourage certain behaviors. But when it comes to stimulating the economy, the effects are minimal and unstable.
All right, well, bring up a good idea with the consumption taxes, but it still isn't generally proven to work. I mean, if you look at the graduated tax rate system, it is effective, it is proven to work, and it is fair. The difficulty is, if you look at it, these taxes aren't graduated taxes, generally welfare, but warfare on the poorest Americans. You're taxing people in a way that they cannot make back their, they cannot supplement their income. It's easy to benefit that with your graduated system. I mean, if everyone is putting in a share that is equal to the amount that they are bringing in and the amount that they are producing and giving into their society, how can you argue that that's a bad thing? You also think we make it simpler. Why not just, you know, to simplify our tax code, not do a consumption tax, but eliminate all of the current loopholes in our tax that make it so that the graduated system becomes so bogged down with problems. And in addition, the graduated tax system is also the lowest rate that it's been in probably 60 years. It's not like we're punishing people for consuming. In fact, we're generally making an escape area for those who consume more than the average Joe. And anyways, you bring it to that idea, maybe it is time for those people who consume to realize that it's sort of a duty to pay into that tax and pay back part of what they produced in this country, because if they did not produce it in this country, they most likely would not have a chance to produce it anywhere else.
To the progressive tax being fair or the graduated tax is the same thing. It's not fair, it is discrimination. Now, yes, the people that make more can't afford it, but it is still discrimination. Now, when it comes to eliminating loopholes, I'd love to eliminate a lot of the loopholes. It makes the tax code very complicated, but I still don't think graduated tax is the best way to go. it can push people into a higher tax bracket just through inflation without that person actually gaining any real income. Because they'll, yes, they'll get paid more, but unless this tax code is revised constantly, which seeing as the two parties can't agree on anything at all ever, it's not gonna get adjusted as needed, as quickly as needed. So that's gonna hurt people that get bumped up to a higher tax bracket without actually getting any more real income. People with a higher earning potentials will just leave. Like, if you're gonna make more money and you're gonna get taxed more, if they can go to a different country where the tax rate is flatter or they won't get taxed as much for making the money they made, why not just leave? It can also discourage business investment and expansion, since more, making more money means they get taxed more. And if they're just barely hitting that upper tax bracket, they could end up losing more money than they're actually gaining. Consumption tax is also a little simpler, because it would just be you buy something, you pay more for it on the spot, unless of course it is necessity. So it's not like you're trying to calculate all these loopholes for what the person made, and it's a lot harder to avoid unless you go black market, but it's really easy to catch all the black market.
I think your point generally neglects the idea of philosophical and the duty that a tax becomes. Essentially, your idea of this consumption tax reduces the significance of that duty. And if people are going to leave the United States because taxes are too high, perhaps they forget the duty that they have to pay it forward in this country, because without the taxes that were paid for them, they would not have the ability to have made it in this country. But about on your point that it graduated taxes and it's discrimination, it may be a form of discrimination, but that form of discrimination is helping the most downtrodden people in this country get out of the hole. So in that case, yeah, maybe a bad fight for the greater good, but it's still helping the greater good of Americans. And I don't see anything wrong with that. I also would like to touch back on your tax cuts for businesses. I do think we have to completely and really cease giving tax cuts to large businesses, because it is financially responsible to do that, to take away from your revenue stream people who can give the most revenue. Small business tax cuts, as seen in New York, or where they're pretty much getting no taxes for 10 years in certain areas of the state, small businesses popping up, are an incredible benefit. But to cut large, I mean, to give tax cuts to large businesses is blatantly irresponsible.
All right, when it comes to the duty of tax becomes, businesses don't care about duty, they care about making money. So, yeah, they probably should be paying their taxes. And if they're going to leave because they're not making it, because they have to pay more taxes, yes, it may be because they forgot their duty, but they don't care about their duty, it's about money. When you come to allowing discrimination, it gets to be a slippery slope. And actually, I guess we've both been contradicting ourselves, because I'm saying you should give tax cuts to businesses to encourage behavior, but I'm also saying discrimination on individual income is bad. But you're saying discrimination on personal income is good. Yeah, we should cut taxes for large businesses because they should be paying more money. But when it comes down to it, that would also be a bad fight for a good cause, because if you're trying to get the green energy or to quit discriminating against race, sex, religion, whatever, tax cuts will promote less bad behaviors and they can encourage more good behaviors.
Well, we already have laws in place that generally discourage and make certain discrimination illegal, so giving tax incentives for that seems redundant. Well, as with the green ideas, we already have federal incentives that apply that. So really, to that end, adding those into tax cuts is generally redundant and do so. Yeah, sometimes it is a bad fight for a good means, but in that case you have to weigh which is the fight, particularly if it's helping end that middle class degradation and the evaporation of our middle class. Our party sees no issue with trying to bring back some income equality to this country.
Got a hand for Taylor and Bill.
Case cited church fired from their jobs, denied unemployment benefits because they ingested peyote as part of a religious ceremony, even though it was illegal in the state of Oregon. The court held that prohibiting the exercise of religion is not the object of governmental regulation, but merely the incidental effect of a generally applicable and otherwise valid provision. This is similar to Burwell, the Burwell case, the Hobby Lobby case, and similar to what you're seeing today. And the ACA's, the Affordable Care Act's contraceptive coverage requirement applies generally and is otherwise valid and trains on women's well-being and not the exercise of religion or any effects it has on such exercise is incidental. There is a senator that was stated in Justice Ginsburg's dissenting opinion, and he observed that by allowing employers to deny coverage based on religious or moral reasons, puts the personal opinions of employers and insurers over the practice of medicine.
It infringes on the rights of those who morally object. It would be like if we forced vegetarians to eat meat. Mandating contraceptives but allowing some exceptions creates serious ambiguities in the mandate law. And mandating contraceptives without any exceptions creates serious ambiguities on the power of the government and what it can and cannot force businesses to do in terms of providing service to their employees. Forcing employers to provide birth control against their moral or religious beliefs is in itself discrimination. The Obamacare mandate discriminates against males failing to make businesses or health insurance provide them and with any sort of contraceptive support. But what has to be done to get pregnant is a choice. Unless one has been sexually assaulted, why do we need to force businesses to provide expensive insurance for birth control for women who can no longer get pregnant if that is the case as well?
30-second final thought, Greta?
Thank you. I just want to address when you said, why do you know something about contraceptives for men? I don't believe there is any on the market right at this time. I could be wrong, but I don't think that that's an issue at this current time. I also want to address a quote by, once again, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. She says, women's rights are an essential part of the overall human rights agenda, train on equal dignity and the ability to live in freedom all people should enjoy. I think it's very important to internalize that quote and think about it when we're talking about women's rights and women should have access to reproductive, like, healthcare. So it's just very, very important to understand that corporations are not people and that people should be able to make their own decisions and have the opportunity to do so. Thank you.
And seconds.
As far as your issue with males and contraceptives, the second case are not by federal government. And we, as conservatives, simply believe that we need to leave it up to corporations and the free market to decide what is covered in their health insurance plans if they so choose to buy health insurance for their employees. And that the reason is because in a free market, you have a choice of where to work, you have a choice to support your voice to be loud in there, so you can make them buy these things if it is economically feasible. And it simply needs to be up to those in charge, those closest to the issue, not federal government, not some sort of overreaching, overbearing entity that is trying to get its hand into every industry.
About a hand. We could have Drew Boso and Bernie Barquette step forward, please. The topic for this exchange is immigration. Two questions were posed for the opening statements. Number one, what is your stance on dealing with the increasing number of illegal immigrants that are passing into the United States? And two, how should we deal with the illegal immigrants that are already in the United States border? And we'll begin with Drew.
Immigration has become an increasing epidemic plaguing our borders and citizens. As our nation advances, our country has utilized its borders to protect its citizens. It is through lawful immigration that immigrants should seek access to our country. I'll start with a few opening remarks from some pretty important people. So one I take is from the National Association of the Former Border Patrol Officers. And they say, certainly we are not gullible enough to believe that thousands of unaccompanied minor Central American children came to America without outside encouragement and assistance. Further, Arizona Governor Jim Brewer says something along the same lines. She says, the administration's refusal to properly verify that violent criminals are not among those entering the United States shows an alarming lack of concern for our homeland security. So now I'm going to talk about a little bit about crime. A prime concern with the increasing number of people crossing our borders is the crime that results. First off, we must not forget that being here without documentation is in itself against the law. What might surprise you is that a third of our prison population is those of immigrants. Thus, it is not only children crossing the border, but hardened criminals and gang members. They go, okay, well, what about that? The Washington Times reported in June that our Border Patrol agents have been stripped of their authority. Take Chris Cabrera, VP of the National Border Patrol Council. He says confirmed gang members in Mexico are crossing the border. Or if that doesn't work, take Art Nacuerto, president of the National Border Patrol Council in Arizona. He says that 16, 17-year-old minors who are members of gangs are being treated the same as any other children, as all the other children. I'd like to make a connection to the ISIS debate that we had earlier. It is confirmed that ISIS people, operatives, are coming into this country. Further, as we have this crime, we're seeing an overpopulation in our prisons, and this is true. And thus, whenever we have become overpopulated, we're seeing a release of these of immigrants back into our population. They're not being necessarily deported, but released. Now, to speak on the argument supporting lawful immigration, it's speculated in the coming months after the election that President, without approval from Congress, will grant amnesty to millions of illegal immigrants via executive action. The current charge against conservatives is that, we don't really accommodate for immigrants, or that we don't care about them. But this simply is not true. This country has provided them a way to access our country legally. Further, it's possible that when they're here, that they're going to get assistance. It is only that they should respect our borders and come here through a legal process. Their unlawful presence has promoted further unlawful behavior and harm to the citizens who say
the issues that you stated. This supposed surge of illegal immigrants into the border is nothing more than what I believe is a fabrication. Because since 2004, 64% less illegal immigrants have been caught at the border, although the amount of border agents has doubled in that same amount of time period. Immigrants are being deported. Since the Obama administration has taken over, the amount of illegal immigrants living in the United States' borders have dropped from 12.2 million to 11.3 million. As it comes to judges, like you said, that we should allocate more judges to so that they could come in legally. In a 2008 Anti-Trafficking Law Act that was actually passed right before the Bush administration left office, it stated that as kids from South American countries in Mexico, that if they came to our borders and they were in danger of becoming sex trafficking slaves, that their cases must be heard by judges and they must be processed and given a fair trial to come to the United States. Well, in response to that, the recent Senate border plan allotted for 50 more immigrant judges to process those cases, as well as $50 million worth of legal services for children. But that plan was shot down in the House by conservatives who said that they would only allow $659 million total to a plan on the border, even though they want to secure it, because of the 2008 anti-trafficking law. So conservatives want the 2008 anti-trafficking law to be repealed, even though they passed it, and refused to help anyone coming in to get in legally. Another thing is you said security. Only 5% of state inmates are illegal immigrants. There may be 20% of federal immigrants, and I will say that is correct there. However, most of those cases are not violent crimes. They are, like you said, border patrol and border offenses. Because someone that does come in illegally through our borders, of course, that is an illegal crime. But of course, that's not a violent crime. They do not hurt the security of our nation. Actually, the people that have been living here, 60% of illegal immigrants living in the United States have lived here for over 13 years. They contribute to a large part of the workforce. They make up 5.2% of the workforce, as reported by the U.S. Department of Labor. Not to mention that they, in two states that hold a lot of electoral votes, in Texas and in California, they control $2.6 million of the employment in Texas and California, which is 10%, and a comptroller from Texas stated that they are 5.8% of the Texas employment. The U.S. Agricultural Department reported that over 50% of their workers are illegal immigrants. These people are not a security threat to the United States. They do not want to come here to harm us. They come here to integrate, and they have integrated. They have also been paying 10% to the Social Security Trust Fund every year. That is $10 billion. So they pay taxes. They live here. They are a part of our workforce. So our solution to the plan, as you said, is amnesty. A plan that was implemented in 1986 for the first time to the masses by a highly conservative president, setting precedent. So I don't know how somebody could go against something set precedent by a conservative Congress, go against laws passed by conservatives, and yet still fail to help illegal immigrants coming in the border.
Drew, 90 seconds of response.
Okay. So you do mention that, I think I'll be able to talk on people that are here legally or illegally, but they are contributing to our country, to our society, to our tax base. And to the legal immigrants, we say, we support you. We have provided this way for you to enter our country. It is to those who have not sought out the way to gain citizenship, gain the right to live here legally, that they have a problem with. I don't know why we should say, sure, it's okay to break our laws when we ourselves hold that we should abide by our laws. As far as the matter of integration, that they come here and they've integrated successfully, I think an opposing argument can be made. We're seeing an increasing number of bilingual ELL programs. So maybe a respect for our borders and culture is maybe not one of their top priorities when they're coming to our country. And so you did mention that immigrants are being deported. I can't argue with that. But I'd also suggest earlier this year, the RFP that was put out that said, that requested a vendor that said, we have these children and we need a vendor that will bring them into our country that will provide for their needs. So just as we have people that are leaving our country, so too do we have their entrance into our country as well.
Thank you. I mean, as I have stated, I'm over here stating facts, stating statistics, and you're over there stating ideals. As I said, the Senate border plan, you said that people are coming into our country. As I said, it would allow $50 million for legal services to children, 50 more immigration judges to process cases. Aid to help Central American countries, so those that we do deport will be able to stay there. And that money would go towards helping fund crime, helping fund the police forces there. It would give overtime for border agents, and then new detention facilities for adequately not only let our people become more integrated, let people be deported, and shut down our border. However, all those plans that you just stated that you would like to be put in place were in place in this bill, were passed by the Senate, and were shut down by the conservatives in the House. So I don't see how someone can stand over there and repeatedly state rhetoric that the Senate has passed, that the liberals and Democrats of the House have passed and the Senate, but yet go against them. As I stated here, economists stated that, well, a small percentage, just five global Nobel laureates, stated, and I quote, while a small percentage of native-born Americans may be harmed by immigration, vastly more Americans will benefit from the contribution that immigrants make to our economy, built including lower consumer prices. Amnesty is the answer. These people are already here. There is no way to get them out without spending trillions of dollars to get them to leave. Including them into our society and locking down the border is the number one way to fix our problem. Yet every time, even though we sit here and we agree on the issues, every time that the Democratic Senate tries to pass a bill to help this and to allow both of our plans to happen, it is shot down for the sole reason that a law that should be helping these children is wanting to be repealed by conservatives in the House.
I don't think amnesty is the answer. I don't think saying to people that you come here, you haven't sought legal, came here legally, but we're going to go ahead and let you stay here anyway. To speak to the quick fact, we have people in prisons that are being released, and these are not just petty crimes. We have crimes of homicide, sexual assault, theft, kidnapping, and alcohol-related crimes. So these crimes that people are being led back to our population is posed as a direct threat to our citizens that should be our top priority. It is our citizens that we must protect through our strong border and a strong, and hopefully,
about a hand there for Drew.
As on security, 50% of the illegal immigrants deported under the Obama administration actually had those criminal records. So not only, so as you state that, once again, with those statistics, that these gang members and these very dangerous illegals are being released, I have statistics proving that not only that they are not being released, maybe some, but most are actually being deported back to their home country, thereby keeping the United States safe. And amnesty is the answer, because these people have lived here for over 13 years. That is longer than it would have taken them to live here, become a citizen of the United States. So I think we owe them, and it is our duty to integrate them into our society and to make them American, because they are a contribute to our laws, they follow our laws, they contribute to our Social Security, they pay taxes, they're part of our workforce, and they're a member of America. And we should do amnesty as something that, once again, was introduced by conservatives to allow these people to formally become American and let them stop hiding in fear.
We could have Jordan Wolfe, Tyrone Peaks, and Mark Stanford come forward. Next topic to be discussed is health care. Two questions were posed for the creation of opening remarks. Those two questions are, to what degree should the government regulate health care? And two, do you believe in the expansion of Medicaid? We'll begin with Jordan Wolfe.
I believe that the Affordable Care Act has been an appropriate degree of how we should regulate our health insurance. Also known as the Patient Protection Affordable Care Act, it has done multiple things that have helped regulate some of the problems that were in our healthcare system. We have seen Part D, which is part of the Medicare Modernization Act in 2003, presented by President George Bush, a conservative, it closed a loophole that is known as the donut hole. Donut hole essentially has a catastrophic level and a regular level, and there's an in-between. And that in-between makes it the person who has the insurance have to pay the 400% of the prescription drugs. With the donut hole being closed, that prescription drug coverage is now going to be dropped down to 25% throughout their time with their insurance by 2020. Other things part of the Affordable Care Act, we have over 8 million people who are enrolled through the program, the state exchanges. As of March of 2014, 30 million Americans are now available to receive health care coverage. There are accountable care organizations that reduce Medicare spending that has been seen throughout Medicare for the last previous couple of years. Students are now able to stay on their parents' insurance until they are the age of 26. Pre-existing conditions cannot be denied because of the Affordable Care Act. Fun thing, if anyone goes to a fast food restaurant, you now see calories are now labeled. The reason why those labels are now there is because it's consumer protection through the Affordable Care Act. There are several things that have been provided for the Affordable Care Act, but Medicaid expansion is the biggest part. And the reason why this Medicaid expansion has occurred is there are subsidies to those who have not been able to receive insurance because they have either A, have been denied, or they have not had the affordability to pay for the insurance, and there's a subsidy given. The Obamacare is not an actual insurance policy, it is a name. Obamacare helps subsidize patients who do not have the appropriate response to paying for health insurance, which has again been so rapidly increasing over the last several years.
Well, for short, Obamacare was not the answer for America. Imagine a nation where 13.4 of the people were insured, which is down 1% from 2008. All these individuals must pay a fine to the government if not being insured. In fact, this is the Obamacare we live in. I believe in a free healthcare market, a small effective government, the safety net to keep these people need of critical treatment and medication. I don't believe anyone should be forced to purchase this service if they. As conservatives, we want to encourage, but again, not force personal savings.
So we believe in several different options that could counter Obamacare. So one of the major issues with Obamacare, as Tyrone here has said, is that although we are claiming that we're helping more people gain access to insurance, based on notes from 2008, only about 1% of the population has gained more access. And let's remember that it is mandatory. That means that we're telling everyone in the United States that they have to have health care, yet 13.4% of people in the United States still do not have health care. There are alternatives. How about we open up a market across states? We allow competition between states. Did you actually know that when they started Obamacare, West Virginia, two companies actually left the state because they were unable to afford it? There's currently only one health care provider through Obamacare in the state of West Virginia. This means that those people have one option, and those prices are sky high. We have several solutions. Because we all have different beliefs, first off, we believe that we can either leave a free and open market where we open up all healthcare across states and allow people to choose and employers to choose. But I suggest an alternative option where we have government-funded and government-initiated personal savings healthcare programs. So this means that from the day you're born, you get $2,000 in your bank account. Now, what does this mean? Okay, it's going to cost more than $2,000 if you end up in the hospital. Well, every year that builds up, you get another $2,000. If we eliminated Medicare, Medicaid, and Obamacare, we could fund this program and still spend less money. And this also means that if I wanted to share my money with, say, my friend Keith, who just spent a week in the hospital, I could share my money with him. As this builds up over time, their money, of course, is added to it, and then anything, any of the added money coming from the bank would be added to it as well. And what this also means is that you can now go out and buy your own major medical. Up until about the 1950s and 60s, healthcare did not exist. Healthcare was out of pocket. We now have an opportunity to reduce the cost of healthcare by taking out the middleman. It means that when I go to my doctor, a healthcare shot is now $20 instead of the $200 they're charging my health insurance. And my family now can afford to purchase major medical for any major incidents that might land me in the hospital.
You brought up a great point that healthcare insurance has not really been popular since the 1960s in the United States. There's this thing about American exceptionalism, where we live, we're the greatest country in the world, and we continue to have the best policies, but when our regulations aren't appropriate to what is going on, then you start seeing that there are several financial burdens that are putting on to United States citizens. Some interesting points you brought up, too, about the West Virginia businesses. What's nice is, if you're a small business, you actually receive a 50% of the insurance, and then get matched by the federal government. Other things with the Affordable Care Act. That Medicaid expansion, the first 2 years, 100% from the federal government, the third year, 90%. This is all through the state exchange. Some other things that you brought up is that, you have a lot more options as a conservative, you believe in more options. Well, based off the Wall Street Journal, they actually agreed that, there's a big Republican misconception that the system of Obamacare was a paradise for free market. Actually, the individual market was struggling to fill gaps, and there was possibilities of it bankrupting the country. To continue going on, the president, it's obviously not the most ideal program to some people. It is a solution to several problems since the 1960s in regulations through Medicare and Medicaid. And you're also seeing that more people have the ability to make the decision. If someone does not want insurance, they don't have to have insurance. They will have to take a penalty, yes, but for the civic interest of the United States, there are some regulations that are provided that are necessary to help make the country more prosperous, and that those who are going to experience extreme debt will be able to have at least an option to what they were previously.
90 seconds.
Well, you made some good points about federal funding. Where do federal funds come from?
Income tax, Medicare.
Okay. This money is tax money. This means more money out of your pocket. All Obamacare has meant for healthcare is higher healthcare premiums. And still, a large percent, almost 15% unemployment across America. This is unacceptable. We are a first world nation. I do agree that we need to be providing accessible and affordable healthcare to Americans across the country. Health savings accounts guarantee that everyone has been allotted some form of care. Currently, you, as a normal tax and spend liberal, would like to tax more of the high business owners and claim to give breaks to the small businesses, but really end up with higher premiums, they end up paying the same amount of money. That money that's being used, that's subsidized by the government, is still the money of the people. Why are we allowing the government to take our money and pay for our health care? We can take our money and pay for our health care, and that's the beauty about the personal health savings account.
A lot of hand there.
In
2008, then-Senator President Obama ran a platform of implementing a universal health care. He did pass that health care package in 2010. In 2012, the Supreme Court upheld that decision. And in 2012, he was re-elected with his presidential mandate. You know, we may continue to go back and forth on ideology, but the president has offered alternatives that have not been offered by conservatives over the last 20 to 30 years. The Medicare Modernization Act has a complete donut hole that was created and is now being fixed because of the Affordable Care Act. You know, you may not agree with the Affordable Care Act, but it is law, it has been law, and it's going to continue to be law.
Tyrone, Mark, 40 seconds.
First off, I would like to say that we do not have universal health care. As I said, 13.4% of Americans are still uninsured. How can you call that universal? Does everyone have access now? Maybe, but is it still affordable? Highly unlikely, or these people would be paying it. I personally know a steward of a friend who was just in the hospital and did not have insurance because he did not get to keep his plan thanks to Obamacare. And he had to give up his insurance and had a lower rate of insurance. He now had to pay the fine, ended up in the hospital, and is having to pay out of pocket for health care. Although it's all very well that you claim that conservatives have no solutions, I hear this offer you a solution. And at the time, then-presidential candidate Mitt Romney had a solution that he effectively implemented at the state level and provided health care for everyone in his state. And that's what we need to do, not just make this about how can we help people get insurance, but how can we assure that when I walk into a hospital with a serious medical condition, that I'm going to get the care I need. Americans deserve that.
Since Mark talked so long, Tyrone, you can have 15 seconds. The poor guy didn't give you. So you can have 15 seconds before we sit down.
In the 2012 election, 2050 was taken out of Medicare, and out of Social Security, and put into this Obamacare.
How about him?
So, my name is Chris Anderson. I'm going to be debating the government's role in the sale and regulation of firearms. It's an important topic. It's an important topic to debate about and to educate voters on because it is one of the biggest problems that plague our society. It seems like every day we turn on the news and we see another shooting somewhere. So it's definitely something that it's time that we figure out something to do about. So it's important that voters are educated when they go to the ballots on Tuesday.
Okay, Hallie and Chris, please. Question posed to this group for their opening statements was in regards to gun rights. Question posed, what role should the government play in the sale and regulation of firearms?
The Second Amendment states a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. The Second Amendment was based partially on the right to keep and bear arms in English common law and was influenced by the English Bill of Rights of 1689. The Second Amendment is an auxiliary right supporting the natural rights of self-defense, resistance to oppression, and a civic duty to act in defense of the state. We as conservatives uphold the right of individuals to keep and bear arms, a right which originated before the Constitution and was solemnly confirmed by the Second Amendment. We acknowledge, support, and defend the law-abiding citizens' God-given right to self-defense. We call for the protection of such fundamental individual rights. We recognize the individual responsibility to safely use and store firearms. This also includes the right to obtain and store ammunition without registration. We support the fundamental right to self-defense wherever a law-abiding citizen has a legal right to be, and we support federal legislation that would expand the exercise of that right by allowing those with state-issued carry permits to carry firearms in any state that issues such permits to its own residents. Gun ownership is responsible citizenship, enabling Americans to defend our homes and communities. We oppose legislation that is intended to restrict our Second Amendment rights.
Simply put, our government's position should be to protect its citizens through measures such as improved reporting to the National Instant Criminal Background Check System, re-establishing the expired Violent Crime Control Law Enforcement Act of 1994, and closing the loopholes that allow criminals and the mentally ill access to firearms. No other developed nation in the world has gun control laws that are as lax as our country's. To put this into perspective for my counterparts, according to the FBI, 9,263 murders are related to gun violence every year. That's 25 people per day. And they let you believe that our government's role is to sit by and just let this happen. I'd also like to point out, they brought up the argument of the Second Amendment. Until the late 20th century, the Supreme Court interpreted this to mean that the state had the right to maintain arms for a militia. It didn't mean you had the right to own an assault rifle. This is evidenced in U.S. versus Miller, where the Supreme Court ruled that the federal government was not violating your Second Amendment rights by imposing gun control laws. This opinion was even later upheld in modern cases, as we see in McBrown versus Chicago and D.C. versus Heller, which was decided by a conservative Supreme Court, which stated that though we do have the right to keep and bear arms, our government has the right to regulate those arms. To quote the late conservative Supreme Court Justice Warren Burger on his interpretation of the Second Amendment, one of the greatest pieces of fraud, I repeat the word fraud, on the American public by special interest groups in my lifetime. The real purpose of the Second Amendment was to ensure the state armies, also known as the militias, would be maintained for the defense of the state. The very language of the Second Amendment refutes any argument that it was intended to guarantee every citizen an unfettered right to any kind of weapon he or she desires.
Second, so response, please.
In response to gun control laws, studies have proven that nations with strict gun control laws have substantially higher murder rates than those who do not in general. In fact, the 9 European nations with the lowest gun ownership rate have a combined murder rate 3 times that of the 9 European nations with the highest gun ownership rate. The United Kingdom is the most violent country in Europe. Here, the possession of handguns is illegal. There are over 2,000 violent crimes per 100,000 people in the UK, versus in the United States, there are 466 violent crimes per 100,000 people here in America. In the decade following the Labour Party's elections and banning of handguns in 97, this is in the UK, the number of reported violent attacks soared by 77% to 1.2 million in 2007, which is more than 2 attacks every minute. Also in the UK at this time, kitchen knives are being used in as many as half of all stabbings in the UK, and they have prompted a group of doctors to call for a ban on long-pointed kitchen knives as well. With just one exception, every public mass shooting in the USA since 1950 has taken place where citizens are banned from carrying guns. So even though we might have these laws that prevents certain individuals from obtaining a permit or obtaining a weapon, that does not mean that they will not get their hands on somehow.
First, briefly touch on, she states that the 9 countries who have the lowest gun control laws also have the lowest murders. You should probably also know they have mandatory military service, and they're all trained and they've all been psychologically evaluated before they ever touch a firearm. Now to move along to her argument of effectively guns don't kill people, people kill people. She's correct. A gun doesn't kill someone by itself. However, there's no argument that they provide a quick, cheap, and relatively detached way to do so. To say they have no part in the perpetration of acts of violence is just absolutely absurd. Looking at this logically, a tool may simply be a part in achieving a desired result, but it's not fair to claim the tool has no part in it at all. It's absolutely completely unrealistic to hope that one day there's not going to be any gun crime, but this doesn't mean that we should just sit here idly and let travesties continue to happen, like the one that happened last week, without taking any action. It's just crazy to think so.
I thought, Alec?
There will always be a negative side to firearms. It's very simple. That's always going to be there. But every year, guns are used over 80 times more often to protect a life than to take one. And 200,000 times a year, a woman uses a gun to defend herself against sexual abuse. I don't understand why people can't see the positive aspect as well as the negative aspect as well. You know, even though the publicity of the negative aspect of gun laws and school shootings and everything that has been happening recently, you still need to take into consideration that, you know, in some cases that aren't being shown nationwide, a gun was used to save a life instead of taking one.
If I could, I'd like to touch on her statistic that guns have saved lives. Actually, according to the Brady campaign, in houses where firearms are present, the average homicide rate is 3 times higher than it is in houses without guns. That suicide rate makes it 5 times higher. Gun accidents due to improper storage take the lives of hundreds of children every year. Rather than sitting here and debating your Second Amendment constitutional rights the Supreme Court has already decided, we should take action to prevent criminals and the mentally ill from gaining access to firearms, and we should pass legislation that makes it just as easy to access mental health care so these travesties don't happen, that would be just as easy as it is to access a firearm.
How about a hand for Chris and Howard? Our last discussion item. Please, Casey and Keith, step forward. It's regarding the minimum wage. The question that was posed for their opening remark was, what should the appropriate method to raising the minimum wage be, and why? Let's begin.
$13, $14. What happens?
per year
in food stamps. Well, how's that possible? Bringing people just above the threshold of where they can get this government aid. So what's their net change? They're losing this assistance that they had. They're gaining some income, but it's, there's not much. But the negatives it causes are significant. Benefit, I don't see it. Negatives, absolutely.
But Casey, 90-second response.
Okay, so you addressed the fact that there would be an increased inflation by a very large amount. But because the increments are so small for the Fair Minimum Wage Act, it's been proven by the Center for Economic Policy and Research and the Economic Policy Institute that it would have a very modest effect on job loss and inflation. And like you said, yeah, 13 states in the union have an indexed minimum wage, but after the third effect, the third stage of the Fair Minimum Wage Act, it will be indexed. It will rise to inflation. There will be time to adjust to that. And since including Ohio are indexed, so that will keep the economy going. Even large businesses will have to make up for the losses somehow, like you said. But it won't be bump-up economics. There will be small periods of time where you could do wage compression, which, like you said, it would cause unrest with higher-wage workers. But since there's so much money being injected back into the economy, for a very long period of time.
Got a hand.
The money that's being injected back in the economy, one thing that's said for is production costs don't necessarily translate directly into buying costs. These are really apples to tables. And for our discussion here, McDonald's, Burger King, food service makes up more than half of minimum wage workers. They're a good example of this, that if their labor goes up, it doesn't mean their products. However, if the market can bear a higher price, they are absolutely capitalists, as you can see from McDonald's being so adverse to unionization. They will charge as much as they can. So, if all this money is being injected back in the economy, market has higher prices go up, everyone's buying out, and that's everything. I think that, you know, the purpose of minimum wage is to protect young people, to give them a way to get a job, learn how to work, and be productive in society. It's to protect unskilled workers. Our focus should be to train the unskilled workers with skills so they can be a productive in society, not to make it easier for people to stay at that bottom line. We shouldn't encourage that mediocrity.
Final comment, 30 seconds, please, Casey.
Well, when you factored in production costs, the productivity of the American worker has gone up exponentially. So the production cost would go down. Obviously, there's more productivity going on. You really don't need as many workers. However, two-thirds of all people working in low-wage jobs are employed by big businesses who could stand to lose the money. And there are 11 different methods of compensation adjustments that could happen in exchange of job loss. You also said that the minimum wage job is for primarily younger people, but 88% of all minimum wage workers are over 20 years old. It reduces work turnover in teens, like you said, but it also reduces worker turnover in the adults, like I said, makes up 88% of all minimum wage jobs by 2.6%.
because of the decrease in jobs, now it's financially possible to automate all these jobs, which is not possible. One thing you do by raising this minimum wage is you make it financially justified for more companies to automate. It means less jobs. It means less entry-level jobs for young people or anyone. But as far as the statistics about who holds these minimum wage jobs, it's 50.2% are between 16 and 24. So even though the 88% are over 20, you're falling, you know, they're younger than 20. Window, not by a huge margin, but they are, which is the way it should be. It should be young people holding these jobs. And again, you know, we shouldn't be saying, okay, you're 35, you're unskilled, we're going to make it easier for you. No, we should say, you're 35, you're unskilled, how do we get you a skill?
Want to answer, Keith? So our task right now is to take what we learned, think through it. We have an opportunity over the next few days to sit and have good conversation individually with people. Have a chance to sit down at Wendy's or the Crispin Dining Commons or Chick-fil-A or Dunkin' Donuts or wherever and talk a little bit more and a little bit more, because our greatest responsibility is to make sure we cast an informed vote. So here's the last question I'm going to throw at you two. Let's make a hypothesis that Tuesday is over. You are now cast into the moment where, regardless of what happened Tuesday, we have to go forward. Okay, we have to progress together. If you were in a leadership position for our country or our state, you can pick either one. What, and I'll give you the first chance there, Mark, what would be the first thing that you would walk across to the folks you've debated and say, you know what, together, let's get this done? What would be that first thing that you would?
Say I was elected to the federal government, the first thing I would walk to the other side and say, let's get done, is let's get our deficit under control. Our deficit is out of control. Our government is taxing and they're spending, and the American people deserve better. If we're going to create programs for the citizens of this nation, they need to be small and they need to be effective. No more, let's try this, let's try that. Let's make something that works. Let's not try it. And I think Democrats or liberals, however you look at it, because we're a non-party affiliated group and we're not identifying as Republicans, although someone in our organization may, I think this is something that we can all agree on. Let's get our deficit under control. Let's make our government manageable again, and let's make it about the people.
Mark. Okay, Ernie. Wait. We got a new rule. We change the rules as things go. You can't use the deficit. Okay? Assuming you may have or may not have. Okay? What would be the first thing that you would walk together with your colleagues and say, we've got to get this done together?
What I would say is I wouldn't pick one certain topic.
Wait a minute, Ernie. You have to pick. Stop.
The topic that I would pick.
Okay, the topic. I'm the moderator around here.
Here's the bipartisanship. That is for killing this nation. Because as fun as it is that we stand here and my kids and we sit on this side and we say we believe in this, I know Mark and the conservatives sit on that side and they believe in that. The most important thing that we must do is meet right here, right down here. We don't have any issue whatsoever. We can have ideas and they can have ideas, but just like negotiating anything in the world, we start here, you start here, we meet in the middle. So not to fix the deficit, not to fix ISIS, not to fix education, but to fix the one idea that no matter what issues come up in the country, no matter what time of period you look at this country, if you're pulling this country apart, is bipartisanship. And that's what matters, and that's what we must fix before anything else.
All right. We've got to fix bipartisanship, we have to work together, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay, now give us an issue.
An issue?
He gave an issue. Okay.
Education reform is the fact that we need to educate our future young children, and that there is no future without a great education, and that we can try and fix the deficit, we can try and fix anything else, but our young children need to be educated. And whether it's through charter schools, whether it's through public school system, whether it's through any sort of school system, the compromise we must make is on education. Because if the education in the United States keeps going down the way it is, if the education in the United States keeps lagging behind everyone else in the global economy and the global world, the U.S. will fail to succeed in the future. And that, before anything else, is what we must fix.
How about a hand for everyone? We want to thank all of you for coming and taking part. We hope that it was profound in certain ways for many of us to learn more and to hear different views from different situations. And so now we have a chance to go forward and work together and get all your friends out there to vote and make sure that you're working with them to be informed voters and make sure that we can make a difference. Thanks so much for the guys that came up with this idea, guys and gals. Sorry, Abigail, they came up with this. It was a lot of fun. You're going to have to cover me. I'm late for an event, so if my wife calls any of you, I really was here with you. Education reform. And here's the question, starting with Tony Peterson. Okay? And it's, what is your stance on charter schools, distribution of funding, and student loan reform?
In Ohio, charter schools began over 15 years ago as an attempt to improve education in Ohio's worst performing school districts. They have failed. When charter schools are compared against public schools in Ohio's Big 8 urban districts, where charter schools compete directly against public schools, the public schools clearly come out ahead. Charter schools in these 8 districts are 13.8% less likely than public schools to meet the state performance benchmarks. Furthermore, 93% of charter schools scored a D or F on graduation, compared to only 73% that they gave public schools. Given these poor results, state taxpayers might be surprised that they pay double the amount when students attend charter schools instead of public schools. In spite of these facts, Governor Kasich has worked diligently to expand charter schools by signing legislation that expands vouchers for children to attend them. When critical resources are diverted to charter schools, public schools continue to perform poorly, while charter schools do even worse. In addition to charter schools, equitable school funding also prevents many Ohio students from receiving full access to a quality education. As it stands today, a typical Ohio school district must earn 52% of its funding from local property tax levies. Top-performing European nations such as Finland, Switzerland, and Netherlands do not rely on property taxes to fund education. In the Netherlands, a typical underprivileged child is guaranteed to receive almost double what a middle-class child receives. Property values in a district should never stand between an Ohio student and a quality education. We must implement a system that guarantees every child an equitable amount of funding. For college students, student loans are increasingly becoming a point of concern. America's student loan burden has eclipsed $1 trillion. Young Americans have been forced to put off major life decisions such as getting married, buying a home, and having children. Several Nobel Prize-winning economists agree lowering student loan payments can stimulate the economy by providing young adults the cash flow they need to further engage in the economy. Given this fact, college students cannot understand why big banks are allowed to borrow money from the Fed at 0.75%, and we must borrow anywhere between 4.7% and 7.2%. The federal government can afford to give highly profitable banks this rate. They can certainly afford to give it to America's college students as well. Our nation needs young workers to fully participate in the economy, and we need lower student loan interest rates to make it happen.
Student loan reform must be a top priority. Thank you. So, I heard you say several times about charter schools and how they're not meeting standards. There's a beautiful thing about charter schools, and they offer the students of the state of Ohio and many other states, including my representative, options. Students and parents deserve options. I'm sure all of you here apply to more than one university, and that's because you enjoy the fact there are options. Regardless of where schools are falling on the testing standards of the state, which although they are important, do not necessarily declare if the school is successful or not. Many charter schools specialize in things such as the arts or technology, and these are drastically important to the development of our society. Another point is that when you say that they're failing to state standards, you're telling me that the state standards are the end-all be-all of education. That's the beauty of our education system. We can send a student to a charter school, get him out of a low-income area, now give him the opportunity to get a quality education, an equal opportunity to get quality education, and he can learn in a different way. maybe some of the reason that these students are not performing adequately in charter schools is because they're learning different than they are in the public schools. It's very clear that if you go to any public school, you'll see the same general teaching styles and teaching techniques. I guarantee if you go to a charter school, you'll see much more immersion, you'll see much more discovery learning. Guess what? Standardized tests are not designed to test this style of learning. When it comes to education funding, I would completely agree with you. Our education funding model is completely unfair. It is essential that we make sure that every single student across America has access to a quality education. To me, this means student school vouchers. This means that every student would get a voucher for the same amount of money, and the student can then choose which school to go to. Again, aren't options a beautiful thing? We need to make sure that each and every student is getting educated, and this will prevent so many other problems in our society. When it comes to student loans, I again agree, student loans are crazy. But the bigger issue is the cost of university. A new study came out last week saying that over the past 30 years, universities have put more money into administrators, almost sixfold, and have decreased the amount of full-time educational faculty they had. We need to ask ourselves, do we really need to be spending all of this money for these positions? A lot of these positions, such as financial aid, have been created because of bureaucratic systems, such as the federal grant program.
I'm happy to hear that Mark agrees that we need a better funding system. Unfortunately, the Ohio Republican Party does not. Governor Kasich released his new budget for 2013. I followed it very closely. He said all sorts of nice things about how we're going to increase based on whether students have special needs, whether they're talented or gifted, whether they speak English as a second language. So we all were happy. We thought that, okay, so they're going to do something about it. Well, when the numbers actually came out, what we found was something entirely different. Wealthy public school districts in the Columbus area, like Dublin, received to the tune of $16 million in increases. Rural districts all around this state that have very low property tax bases, they did not receive very much. Some of them only received $30,000. Some of these districts, unfortunately, have not had a property tax levy in 30 years. A representative from his office was asked about this by the media. They started to say that superintendents have said that we don't quite understand what's going on when some districts are getting this much money and we're getting nothing. The spokesperson said that it's not the numbers that matter, it's the philosophy that matters. I asked myself, I wonder if he would have adhered to that philosophy when he was a partner at Wayne Brothers. Something says to me that he wouldn't. It's all smoke and mirrors, and it's not good for Ohio students. We need real equitable funding, and Republicans are not willing to provide
it.
I'm not sure if you're really here trying to debate me or Governor Kasich, but I am not Governor Kasich, and I have offered other solutions. We are a non-party affiliated group. These ideas are strictly my ideas. I would agree with you. I think there are better ways of funding education. We need to make sure that every student doesn't just get an education, but gets a quality shot at a fair education. Cities such as Philadelphia and Pittsburgh have been great examples of how charter schools offer these options. One of my family members, actually, who was raised, born to the streets of Philadelphia, has now made his way to a full scholarship direct to the university, thanks to an opportunity he got by going into a charter school. Educate students in many different ways, and this is what makes America so successful. The diversity that we have, the diversity in our education, the different ways that we learn, and the different ways that we can learn. This is essential to the development of our nation.
Final thought on education reform.
On charter schools, it's not necessarily the testing standard. Mark is correct. Testing does not equal testing everything that a student is capable of. Unfortunately, in the state of Ohio, a high school diploma is required to go to college and receive a high-paying job. If you go to a charter school in the state of Ohio, you are 20% less likely to graduate with that quarter high school diploma. So although there might be a few success stories, we have to look at what's happening on the whole. Charter schools suck $900 million out of public schools. They receive more than their fair share. They take some of the local tax money that voters voted to go to the public schools and not to the charter schools. And in return for that, they give our students a 20% less chance of graduating and moving on to good jobs and to college. So, no, on the whole, there might be a few success stories, but charter schools do not work. They're not a good choice, and it's best that we promote our public schools so we can give students the best chance at quality life.
Funded by public money. In fact, charter schools are the epitome of what our society believes in. That our society, saying everyone in this side of the room, we have decided that we would like to send our kids to a school that's going to specialize in, say, industry. Imagine that, Youngstown, a school with industry. If we now send all of our kids there, we as a community have decided on quality education. I do agree with you. We need to get graduation rates up. This is important. But you have to consider that possibly maybe less students are passing charter school because there are higher school standards, possibly because the students going into them were unprepared to go into them. And you also have to consider that it's possible that all of the students going to charter school may have been unsuccessful in public school. It's unfair to just make the assumption that because of those few success stories, we have to write off charter schools because there's not enough. I know plenty of people who have gone to charter schools, public schools, and it's been essential to them. This diversity in education is important. I'm going to spend the rest of my life teaching, and I know one thing for sure, that if I try to teach you all in one way, it's not going to work. I have to teach all of you in an individual way, and charter schools allow for this to happen.